Hello, everyone. Let's continue with the work that we've been doing. And let me get the practice exam for Chapter 6, MATC work. This is good for anybody looking at any mathematics that they need help with pertaining to this subject matter, and has really good applications in numerous fields. It's so great about the Math 107 at MATC. It's got a lot of broad applications and gets you started with a lot of stuff that you might want to go into. They show various conversions on the practice test. Let me try to set this up a little better. The mic is kind of messing me up a little bit here, guys. All right. Okay, so essentially, guys, we're looking at a situation where on the practice exam, they give various conversions, inches to feet, feet to inches, feet to yards, yards to feet, etc. So that's already on here. So I'll just work under the assumption that at the end, when all this scrolls by, you're looking at the practice exam that's scrolling by in the actual film, in addition to the things that I've made available to my students at MATC on Blackboard as well. You'll see the same content, the same practice test. There's 10 questions on this one, and it says here, question 1 of 10, fill in the blanks. For question 1, they want you to convert 24 inches into feet. They also want you to convert 9 yards into feet as well. Well, the conversion factor is every foot is 12 inches. Always put on the bottom the number, always put on the bottom the units from which you want to convert, and put on top the units that you want to get to. The units that you want to get to are on top, and the units from which you start, from which you want to convert and get to the units on top. So if it was the other way around, you'd be going 12 inches per foot, you'd be going feet to inches. Well, in this case, you write it like this. 1 foot for every 12 inches multiplied by 24 inches, these cancel. Well, heck, the 12 and the 24 cancel. You got 2 times 1 is 2 feet. Okay. For yards, same kind of thing. Every yard, I want feet, so if I want feet, I'm going to go, there's 3 feet for every yard. I'm going to multiply by 9 yards. The yards cancel. The ones on the bottom, 9 times 3. There is the idea, you guys, of... That's this right here, and then all right, so here are your answers. There is the idea of like a real common sense look to what's going on. What I mean by that is feet are bigger than inches, so you don't need as many of them. So you got a smaller numerical answer here, but that's because the units are bigger. Yards are bigger than feet, so you need more feet, so you got a bigger numerical answer, 27 as opposed to 9. So always kind of use our common sense in that regard and see what we can do here. Lot of arguments on this. Let's just kind of go for it. For number 2, a volcano on a recently covered planet rises to a height of 73,568.417 feet. Use the table of facts to find the height of the volcano in miles. Round your answer to the nearest tenth. So essentially, guys, if you've got this 73,568.417 feet, and if we look at the table, we know that there's 5,280 feet in every mile, per mile. You want to get miles, so you put miles on top, you put feet on the bottom. And there you go. You're basically taking 5,280 and dividing it into something between 73,000 and 74,000. It's going to be a pretty big number. Let's just cut to the chase. I mean, like I said, you'll see this when you actually do it. You're going to get some kind of a decimal answer, and you're going to round it at that point. After all the round-offs and all that other stuff takes place, you've got 13.9 miles. That's incredible. It's pretty remarkable for a height that we're talking about here, guys. So there it is. So there, let's just make sure here. Yeah, right. So whatever, you're going to work it and you're going to get different answers. I mean, you're not going to get different answers. You're going to get an answer in this ballpark. It's going to be 13 point something. And with the decimal expansion that takes place, you're going to round it to the nearest tenth, and you're going to get right to here. The big thing that sets off is that every 1 mile is 5,280 feet. Whenever there's an equation like that, you can set up a fraction like this. This is the main stuff right here, guys. You can set up a fraction like this, which is what I just did to solve the problem, or you can flip it the other way around. And this also will solve a problem, but it'll solve a different problem. If you're converting from miles to feet, you're using this ratio. If you're converting from feet to miles, you're using this ratio. That's the big thing, more than anything. Okay. Three. Let's see what we got here. A swim race has a total distance of 27.5 miles. It's quite a distance. It's quite a race, huh? A swim race has a total distance of 27.5 miles. Race officials want to mark the course every 1,100 yards with a buoy, including one at the finish line. The starting line does not need a buoy. So after every 1,100 yards, you're putting a buoy. How many buoys are needed? First, fill in the blanks on the left side of the equation using three of the ratios shown, then write your answer on the right side of the equation. Okay, this is kind of, the way they're saying it, you'll see it when they actually print this thing out, you guys. Sometimes writing this thing out on the board is not always the most time-efficient way to go. If we need to do so, we will do so, obviously. But let's see what we've got, what we've done so far, you guys. Okay, so what do we got? We got this. Got this, so that's one and two. For three, they're trying to figure out how many buoys you're going to get, and they want a whole bunch of stuff going on here with that. They give different ratios that are really hard to look at here. You've got to make a distance. I'm not quite sure. Their argument's really not something set in stone, guys. I think more common sense than anything is what we're about. The entire race is 27.5 miles. The way I would take this thing, they're saying to me that every 1,100 yards, you need a buoy. So then write your answer, how many buoys are needed? Well, okay, I'll tell you what. Let me try to think of how they're doing something a little different than what I'm going to maybe do. Looking at this, there's 1,760 yards for every mile. 1,760 yards for every mile. So I'm going to cancel the miles out and have yard, and then it's going to be a pretty big answer. It's going to be numerically speaking, it's going to be 27.5 times 1,760. That's how many yards there are. When you know that's how many yards there are, I don't don't like the way they asked this question. I don't think they need to go that way. I mean, there's more. This is probably the more time efficient way to do it. I think I know what they've done, and I might walk into that in a little bit. But if you get it to here, you know what the yards are. And if you know that there's one buoy, every 1,100 yards, that's it. That's gonna solve the matter. They've got a little more elaborate setup on this thing. I think I know what they've done, but that's not gonna matter. So when you do this, bam, that cancels out. You're gonna know how many buoys are gonna be there. And I'll show you, I'll walk along the lines of what they just tried to say. For three, there's 44 buoys. That's not going to be an issue. I mean, this is fine. The bottom line is the bottom line. You got to give an answer. That's it. That ends it. That solved it. You could have gone like this. The way they're probably wanting you to go. And that's not really a big deal. It's going to be the same answer. If you look like this, you can say that, you know, this it's kind of interesting how they... Yeah, you could have gone with 5,280 feet for every mile. And that cancels here. Now you got feet. And then you take, well, I'll tell you what, there's 1 yard for every 3 feet. Why did that cancel here? This is going to be the 1,700 that you have right here. This is going to be the 1,760 you have right here, right there. That's kind of, they wanted you to make a move like this. I just immediately looked at what I knew the 1,760 was going to work. Once you got that, you got all the yards, then you go one buoy. Every 1,100 yards, and eventually, bam, the yards are going to go, and you're going to have, it's going to be the same answer, you guys. So the way they kind of played it is they said 1, 2, 3, and then have it go, then have it happen. 1, 2, 3. I tacked on two factors, and it got us to where we want to go. They wanted 1, 2, 3. They wanted three factors to get us to go to this, get the same answer. Doesn't matter, guys. That's not an issue. Four, a science fair poster is a rectangle, 48 inches long and 36 inches wide. Some of the entry rules for the fair refer to the area of the poster in square feet. Use the facts to find the area in square feet. It's a great question. All right, so let's take a look at it. Again, this film is predominantly made for the MATC students taking Math 107. All these films right here that are labeled for MATC are for MATC Math 107. I think they give us a lot of good summary, but they're also going to help a lot of people that are looking to get into the higher mathematics at some point, and they want to get more foundational material presented to them so they know a little bit more. So this is for anybody. Math works for everyone that wants to look at something. If you need help with this content, regardless of its initial purpose of being made, it's being made for everyone that might need help with this sort of content. So there's no boundary on that. Okay, so we know that. I've said that from the beginning. So they're saying the poster, you know, they're talking about the way they're talking about it is, you know, the area is length times width. The area, this is very, very important. If it's 48 inches length, 36 inches width, you go for it and you get the answer that you get. you can't just use 1 foot equals 12 inches. It's a lot more subtle than that. It is indeed true that 1 foot equals 12 inches. Nobody's arguing that. However, if two things are equal, we just said that they're equal. We just wrote it down right here and we know they're equal. If 1 foot equals 12 inches, 1 foot equals 12 inches, if you square each side, 1 foot squared is 1 square foot. Square this, it's 144 square inches. Pretty important when you're talking about area. This is for length. This is for area. Heck, I mean, if you got 1 foot and you got 12 inches, as we said here, for the lengths under consideration, and you cube it, 1 cubic foot, that's pretty interesting too. 1 cubic foot is 12 cubed, which is 12 times 12 times 12. Well, 12 times 12 is 144. Times 12 is 288 onto 1440, which is 1728 cubic inches. Let's make sure. Let me just let's actually do that to be sure. So it's not this thing about 1 foot being 12 inches, therefore I'll use it everywhere, is a really bad move. It's an erroneous move. It doesn't work. 1 foot indeed, 1 foot indeed is 12 inches. Nobody's arguing that. But when you, if two things are equal, 1 foot equals 12 inches, when you square both sides, you get 1 square foot equals, well, 12 inches, the quantity squared is 144 square inches. If you cube each side, you got 1 cubic foot, and then you get something like this. So you got to be really careful with the subtlety of the argument here. Now, there's a number of ways you could pull this off. You could say, based on what I just said here, there's a number of ways you could do this. I got a pretty easy way. I wanted to give you this song and dance anyway because I just think it's useful. And this works for other kinds of measurements. This works with meters, centimeters, millimeters, kilometers, cubic centimeters, cubic meters. There's always the idea of how big the steps are and how the steps change when you're talking about this one-dimensional measurements. The inches is to the one power, not written down, but it's to the one power for the one-dimensional space that we're talking about. For two-dimensional space, length and width, it's to the second power. For three-dimensional space, length, dimensions. Good way to look at that as well, to remember it, to remember what's going on. I tell you, I got an idea here. Every time there's 12 inches accounted for, you got a foot. How many times is 12 going to 48? How many times is 12 going to 48? How about four times? How many groups of 12 inches are there in 48 inches? There's four of them. That's 4 feet. How many groups of 12 inches are there in 36? That's 3 feet. You guys know where I'm going. 4 times 3, 12. Feet times feet. That's it. Notice how you don't put the exponent anywhere near the number. You put it by the letter to indicate the dimensions. You don't do anything else. Okay, guys, let's make a long story short. That's the answer. Have a great day if you want to go that way. You could also... Yeah, it's a little harder, but I mean, whatever. You could say that the beauty of the mathematics is this. What's 48 times 36? It's a good question. It's a pretty darn big number. I can tell you it should be, well, I can kind of cheat on this one, guys, actually. Or at least to kind of give you an idea of what's happening here with this. This is going to be basically 144 times more than that. I think at the end of the day, you're going to get this. You're going to get 17, just kind of a fortuitous thing that just happened here, I guess you could say. this is going to be, look, let's not get anything wrong here. This is the area. Forgive me. That is the area, rather. I'll tell you, the other thing I just said was wrong. That's the area. Let's get it really straight, guys. This is the area in square inches. This is the area in square feet. They are identical in terms of size. Somebody could say, it sure doesn't look like it. 12 is a lot smaller than this. Yeah, 12 is 144 times smaller than this. But then again, the square foot is 144 times bigger than a square inch. Because it's 144 times bigger, because a square foot is, here it is, because a square foot, numerically speaking, is 144 times the size of a square inch. That's really what it means. You need 144 square inches to get a square foot. 144 square inches, 144 times the size of a square inch is what a square foot is. Well, that's why I need 144th times as much square feet as I need square inches. I need 144 times smaller amount because this is 144 times bigger than a square inch. You need more square inches than you need square feet to describe the same reality. Now, you could take the 1728 inches squared and you could play the ratio game. Here we go. If these are equal, you can write it as every 1 square foot is equal to 144 square inches. Square inches cancel. The 144 goes into here times square feet stay. Whenever you got any, my friends, whenever you are given an equation like this, or an equation like this, or an equation like this, you can just take this over that, or that over this, and you can do conversions. This divided by that, or that divided by this. So what I'm trying to say is, if I got this, I could say feet, 12 inches, or I could say 12 inches per foot. Yeah, I can use this, or I can use that, depending what the question is. I can use square feet over square inches, or I can use square inches over square feet. Let's see what we got here. Yes, correct. I wrote that down wrong initially. This works. Linear units, area units, volume units, 1728. Cubic inches for every cubic foot. This kind of ratio is always, these kind of ratios are always permissible in the equation. Just set it up. That's all that it is. So let's just make sure they got it here so we're in agreement with them, I guess you could say. 12 square feet. Absolutely. And that's the answer. 12 square feet. That's the one we're going with. Five. A bottle holds 96 fluid ounces of lemonade. How much is this in pints? Going on, guys. All you got to do is find out what's what. Well, I'll tell you what. I know that. I can look it up. One pint is 16 fluid ounces. That means for every one pint, I got 16 fluid ounces, or I got 16 fluid ounces for one pint. All right, sounds good to me. 96 fluid ounces, FL ounces, I'm just going to say ounces, but in this case, 96 fluid ounces. And I'm going to use the ounces. See how many pints that is. That goes into here six times. 6 pints. That's all it is, guys. Don't let too much be read into this. Just let's get the job done. Okay, so that is, at least tell you what number it is that we just did, right? That's number five. Number six, a scientist is working with 5 meters of gold wire. Use the facts to find how long this is in millimeters. Okay, there's a lot here. Potentially a lot here, I guess you could say. See what we got here. Well, okay, I'll tell you what. It's kind of interesting, some of the stuff that goes on here, guys. 1 kilometer is 1,000 meters. Kilo means 1,000. 1 meter is 100 centimeters. How many cents are in a dollar? 100. Well, 100 centimeters in a meter as well. Every meter has 1,000 millimeters. Milli pertains to 1,000. 1,000 millimeters. Okay, well, that's a good way to look at it. So for six, how long is this? Well, I think this is the one that's going to. You can put this over that, or you can put that over this. I need millimeters, so I'm going to put them on top. I'll put meters on the bottom. I'm saying that. So go with that. Guys, I just want to make sure it's not something crazy here, unless I misread something. That's fine. I think it's good. Let's keep going. Six. Well, no, actually, we just did six. Okay, let's go to seven then. They want you some conversions here, and they get pretty interesting, I guess you could say. A hectometer, and then decimeters. Okay, we got to talk a little bit. A 1 hectometer, from the Greek word ekato means 100. 1 hectometer is 100 meters. So we're going to be playing the game with the conversion factors, remembering that. A decimeter is 1/10 of a meter. So there's a number of ways you can handle that one, I guess. Say a decimeter is 1/10 of a meter. So 10 of these decimeters will give you a meter. So I'm going to work with those two things. I think they're going to be of use. So I'm going to work with that, and I'm going to work with that for this. Basically, I think it's a two-part question on this. So we'll make sure it's there. So that's seven. Let us see what they want to say here. Okay, so for 7A, they're saying convert 8.9 hectometers to meters. 8.9 hectometers to meters. There's 100 meters for every one hectometer. How do I know that? Well, I've been discussing that all film long, guys, right? When you got something set equal, you can put this over that, or you can put that over this. So you can go 1HM, you can go 1HM over 100, or you can go, as I did here, 100 over 1HM. Every hectometer's got 100 meters to it. Every hectometer's got 100 meters to it. Go for it. And that's that. Here's your answer for that one. B, convert two decimeters to meters. Well, I'm going to have to put decimeters on the bottom and then meters on top. Well, okay. 1 meter for every, so, you know, again, the ratio's got to be 1 meter over 10 decimeters or 10 decimeters over 1 meter. Same thing here. It'd be 1 hectometer over 100 meters or 100 meters over 1 hectometer. Like this, or like this, or like this, or like this. Well, every 1 meter, we said a decimeter is pretty small. You need 10 of them. You need 10 of them to get a meter. So there's your ratio. Cancel that out. It's 2 over 10, which is 0.2. 0.2 meters. Yeah, you don't need that many meters if they're so much bigger. Yeah, it may be 2 decimeters, but 1/10 of that when you're talking about a meter, because a meter is 10 times bigger. You don't need as many meters to describe the 2 decimeters. So you got this. So that's 7. 8, Yolanda's racehorse weighs 470 kilograms. Use the facts to find how much this is in grams. Well, I mean, there's a lot here. You know, depending who's watching this and what they're looking for. Anybody, any physics students watching this, you're going to know that kilograms is not weight, though we do kind of use that misnomer of weight. Kilograms is mass, but that's okay. I mean, something that's three times as massive as something else is going to have three times the weight on Earth or three times the weight anywhere else. So there's direct correspondence to it, but technically not weight, it's mass. But we're not going to worry about that. The big thing here is, when you look at something like this, is if you got this, you got 8. We know kilogram is 1,000 grams. So the conversion factor is 1 kilogram for every 1,000 grams. Again, we can look this up to see that. Once you see this equation, you can put one over the other and it's a conversion factor. Doesn't matter which one you put on top of the other. In fact, do both separately and then make a decision which one you want to use. I want an answer in grams. I'm not going to use this. It's got kilograms on top. I'm going to use the grams on top to get the answer. The racehorse is 400. The racehorse is 470 kilograms. And we know associated with it. Kilogram, you got 1,000 grams associated with it. That's going to be a big number. Does that mean the thing weighs more? Of course not. It doesn't have more mass. You just need more of it to describe it. If I pay off a debt, I owe you $100. If I pay with one single $100 bill, that's good. If I pay you with 250s, I needed the 250s because each one is half as big as a $100 bill. So I need twice as many of them. If I pay you with singles, I can't pay you with one of them like I paid with the one with the single $100 bill. I'm going to have to pay with 100 singles because each single is 1/100th the size of a $100 bill. If I paid in pennies, it's like 10,000 pennies. Why? Is it more money? It's all the same amount of money, but pennies are 10,000 times smaller than a $100 bill. So you can't pay with one penny. You got to pay, pennies are 10,000 times smaller than a $100 bill. So I need 10,000 times more than that. 10,000 pennies is what I need to pay you off the $100 debt. Same thing here. You're going to need more grams because grams are smaller. How much smaller? A gram is 1,000th the size. A gram is 1,000th the size of a kilogram. You need 1,000 times more of them to get the job done. That's it. Again, guys, I just want to check. I always want to check this stuff. I think it's fine. You always get a little afraid. Right, not a problem here. Everything looks good. Let's talk about the last two. For number nine. A boy weighs 27 kilograms. Again, it's kind of a misnomer. It's not. It's doesn't weigh that. That's his mass. But that's all right. The math is what we care about right now. A boy weighs 27 kilograms. How much does he weigh in pounds? Use the conversion. 1 kilogram is 2.2 pounds. Well, there we go. 1 kilogram. Every 1 kilogram is associated with 2.2. I'll write it like this. They wrote it like that. So I'll write it like that. 2.2 pounds, 2.2 pound. So you need 2.2 1 kilogram. How are you going to write that? It's 2.2 pounds. They write LB for Libra, I think, but I'm going to use their language. 2.2 pounds for every 1 kilogram. Or every 1 kilogram, 2 pounds. Again, it's the same argument we've been doing for a while now, right? How are we going to do this? Use one or the other. I'm going to use this one, I think. So let's see what we got. We're still on 9, so let me go over here. Let's take a walk over here. Start with 9, somewhat fresh. We got 9 here. And I'm basically going to take 27 kilograms. And I'm going to go 2.2 for every 1 kilogram. If you do that, 2.2, it basically comes out to 54 plus 5.4 is 59.4. 100 pounds. Makes sense. If the unit is a smaller unit, you need more of that smaller unit. I needed 10,000 pennies to pay off the $100 debt that I had with that person. I could have given him $100 bill. I could have given him $25 bills. Notice, the smaller the denomination, the more you need to give. And that makes sense. If I'm trying to bail out a huge barrel and just try to get the water out of it, I can do it with maybe 100 buckets or whatever. But if I do it with thimbles, I might need 1 million of them or whatever. I mean, you get what I'm trying to say. The smaller the steps you're taking. I can walk across this room with 5 big steps or 20 really small steps. It's the same distance, but when the steps are smaller, when the thimbles are smaller than the buckets, when something's smaller, you need more of them. Something's bigger, to the contrary, when something's bigger, you need less of it. All right, so let's see what it's got here. It should be fine. And like I said, you're going to have this scroll. And I got 59.4 LB. LB is really what the units really are, guys, when you're making this conversion. I mean, I'm not going to, you know, we're not going to beat this thing up. 1 kilogram is 2.2 libras. That's pounds. And we could have done it just like that. They gave the answer just like that, which is good too. So it's 59.4 pounds. Write it as pounds or LB. I don't think they're making a big deal of that right now. A cyclist rides his bike at a speed of 40 kilometers per hour. He's really moving. What is this speed in miles per hour? How many miles will a cyclist travel in 4 hours? In your computations, assume that 1 mile is equal to 1.6 kilometers. Do not round your answers. Okay, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. If that's the case, let's go to number 10. So for number 10, they're telling us that 1 mile is 1.6 kilometers. Okay, that's a big thing. If this is what the case is, how are we going to do it? Well, we're going to do what we've always done. 1 mile, 1 mile for every 1 mile for every 1.6 kilometers, or 1.6 kilometers for every 1 mile. Both ratios, this ratio and its reciprocal, or this ratio and its reciprocal, these two are reciprocals of each other. They're both equally valid. Now, we want an answer in terms of kilometers. I want kilometers on top if I want to get kilometers for an answer. If I want kilometers for an answer, if they gave me miles. Actually, I'm going to want this one because they want miles. They're saying here, he rides at 40 kilometers per hour. What is his speed in miles per hour? Well, if he's kilometers per 1 hour, and I multiply by the ratio 1 mile for every 1.6 kilometers, looks good to me. It's going to be 40 divided by 1.6. I think it's going to be 25. Let's have a look at it. I'm trying to put together a little bit, guys. If I could, if I went 4 in here, it'd be 10. I'm just trying to figure this out here, guys, really quickly here. 4 in here, I'd get 10, then 0.4 would be 25. I'm getting 20, when I do this, I can always look at this, guys. I'm getting 25 miles on top. The hour ain't changing. And there's a number of ways we could have done this. We run out of time a little bit when we do it, but this is the speed. 25. How far are they going to go in 4 hours? Well, if they're going 25 miles, if they're going, forgive me, guys, I got to get some chalk here. They're going 25 miles every hour for 4 hours. It's, let's figure it out. X is going to be the distance. It's 25 miles. Every 1 hour, and you're traveling for 4 hours. Second part of that answer, so let's make sure we got that. That's all it is. They use H rather than HR. I use HR for hours. They use H. H is frequent in a lot of textbooks. I've seen it in physics books, mathematics books possibly as well. Okay, that gets us through this. That is a little practice for you regarding some of this stuff. So we got it. Let's go to test chapter 7. Let's go to test chapter 7. And Just want to make sure of a couple things, guys. Yeah, let's go to test chapter 7 for the next next area of endeavor. And it gets a little bit in some trigonometric concepts, which is very useful if you're ever going to go into engineering or physics or, you know, some other architecture, I'm sure. I don't know, but for sure engineering and for sure in physics and higher level mathematics, you want to go into it. This can be very useful. So again, it's not just useful for people in my class. Right now at MATC, it's useful for anybody anywhere if you want to look at some of this stuff. We'll give it a basic presentation of some stuff to look for. It's not going to be heavily emphasized in the more basic mathematics classes that you're going to find, but in higher material, it does get emphasized. So it's good to just get some exposure to this stuff. Okay, let's go to that, and we will talk soon.